Well, when I became administrator for the estate in 1992 and opened up his political office and discovered that there were boxes and boxes of letters and documents, the thing that struck me the most was the hundreds, if not thousands, of letters of recommendation he wrote for his constituents. I've never gone through all of them because there's just too many of them. And the range of individuals that he would write these letters for was extraordinary. I found a letter of recommendation he wrote for a guy who had a shoeshine business in an alley about four blocks from his office that he wrote to the local police captain in the precinct saying that he vouched for this guy and would you leave him alone and let him do his business. All the way to letters to Springfield vouching for people who were trying to get jobs with the state auditor's office or the governor's office or the Department of Corrections or the bank exam, sorry, it went on and on and on. People just trying to get jobs locally at some of the factories in town, at the armor meatpacking plant, school systems, sheriff's offices. It just went on and on and on. I can't imagine how many thousands of lives this guy touched directly. And for the better. I mean, that was his goal. It was to level the playing field for African Americans and give them the opportunities to do any job that they were qualified to do. And I think that was his greatest contribution, was to open those doors for people who were qualified to do anything that they wanted. He didn't suffer fools easily also. He was not a man that could be taken or hustled. He was a big guy. He was 6'3", about 240 pounds. Wasn't afraid to use his hands or his fists if he had to. You know, Chicago politics, that was a rough game. Still is a rough game now, but it was rougher back then when he was in office. There were a couple things that that really stood out were some of the letters he had written and received. He always kept them together. The letter he wrote and then the response that came in, he would take a paperclip and put them together. And he had letters from Fiorello LaGuardia was a good friend of his. They'd been in Congress together. In fact, he was one of his biggest defenders in Congress. LaGuardia, and LaGuardia was aghast at the way that he was treated. In fact, there's a quote from him. In 1930, he says, "It is manifestly unfair to embarrass a new member of Congress, and I believe it is our duty to assist new members rather than to humiliate them." So after that, they were like lifelong buddies. There are letters from Hoover, governor of Ohio, Illinois, Michigan, West Virginia, thanking him for coming out to those states and helping with elections that took place in those states. He was a diehard Republican. And it kind of contributed to his downfall politically because he didn't see the tide changing in the 30s. And then Arthur Mitchell, who ran against my great-grandfather and defeated him, he was the first African-American Democrat member of Congress ever elected. So my great-grandfather went back to politics by getting himself elected back to the Chicago City Council in 1943 and continued, you know, his efforts to better the lives of his constituents. Again, he had no problem reaching across both sides of the political aisle to do that. And there was an incident in 1944 which really stood out. In his efforts to try to level the playing field for his constituents, he had reached out to Mayor Ed Kelly and got his support in passing a Fair Employment Practice Act in the city of Chicago that DePriest had introduced in the city council, which, by the way, had failed in the state legislature in Illinois earlier that year. He wrote an open letter addressed to his Republican voters, friends, and citizens in 1944 because he had been lambasted by the Chicago newspapers for supporting Kelly, of course, who was a Democrat. And he said, and I quote, "I contended then, and I still contend, that if Negro people are good enough to give their lives for their country, they are then entitled, wherever qualified, to hold any position in their country's government which they are helping to maintain through their taxes, their blood, and their loyalty." I think that really hits the nail on the head, where DePriest, kind of the core of his character was coming from.